action. Rotarians and guests, our charity for today, managed by Brian Harris and Kay Dowling, is Calperum. Would you all please give generously into the begging bowls on your table? Thank you very much. And while you're placing your money in the bowl, I'd just like to say a few words to introduce our guest speaker today. It's a very great honour to have Shaikh Imam Tawhidi with us today. I think you're going to be in for a... I need to speak up? Oh, I think the microphones must have been set up for Darcy, were they? God, I've never been accused of, you know, whispering before this moment. Thank you. So we're in store for a very special speech today. I know a lot of us have preconceived ideas about Islam and Muslim and Muslims and ISIS and so on. And I think having got a chance to do some research and get to know Imam Tawhidi a little bit in recent months, I think you're going to find a rather surprising and heroic individual who's taking a stand on many of the issues that we share. He was born in the Holy City of Qum in Iran into a spiritual family who've spent decades in Islamic seminary. I think he's a third generation imam. He's an Australian Shi'a Muslim, and he is the imam of the Islamic Association of South Australia. So he's the top man, shall we say. He's a fascinating character because he is an educator, a speaker, a preacher, a thinker, a researcher, and an author. And he's very busy in his social networks giving voice against ISIS and extremism in particular. In fact, I think many would say that the Imam is Australia's leading critic of ISIS and terrorist activities. There's a film called The Silence of the Lambs that you'll all know, and there's another production in the offing called The Silence of the Imams. And our guest today, Imam Tawhidi, is one of the very few, if not the only imam in Australia who's prepared to speak out openly and publicly on these very sensitive issues, where his brothers and all those others in the cohort remain silent. He calls on Muslim imams to speak out and condemns the silence. So would you please give a warm welcome to Shaikh Imam Tawhidi.
Respected President, Administration, members of the Rotary Club of Adelaide, peace be upon you all. When my parents came to this country, they came because of Saddam Hussein's oppressive regime and the mass executions and the problems therein. But why did they come to Australia when many Muslim countries were still at peace? They could have gone to any other country that had no war. Many of the Arab Gulf countries are beautiful as you see them today. But my father made the choice, and he was an imam himself and still is. He made the choice to come to Australia because it was a non-Muslim country. And he wanted to adapt, and he wanted his family and children to adapt to that type of a lifestyle and follow that type of law. Now, since I've been assigned in Adelaide to lead the Muslim community within my denomination, I've been subjected to many death threats, many problems. Some of you might have seen me on television. The main issue we have as Muslims is the fact that we, excluding myself, haven't had the chance to adapt to this society. And the problem here doesn't start off with Muslim private schools or the language barrier between the Muslim parents and their children. The problem starts with the Grand Mufti, who is the top Muslim leader in this country, who dresses in a suit and tie to blend in. And this is what I have always stood against. It's hypocrisy to blend in. Dress in what you want to dress, but adapt to this society and do not try to change it. Now, if we knew that after 30 years we're going to have burqas running around and mosques being erected in every corner and people proposing Sharia law against democracy in this country, we wouldn't have come. But since I've been raised here and I drank Australia's water and ate its bread, I am not prepared to stay silent when I see people wishing to change this country and change its values and the democracy within. I believe that there is one law that should be followed in this government and in this country, and it's the Australian law that we all elect and agree upon. But why is it that nobody really understands Islam? You can go and study for 20, 30 years, but you will never, as a non-Muslim, understand how Muslims really think. And unless someone speaks out and tells you exactly how Muslims think, you will never know. Even if you convert to Islam, you're still not going to know. That's something that has been inherited by every Muslim since the emergence of Islam. How Muslims think. But why is it that I am being attacked and I suffer from death threats when I just want to spread peace? I sit with a Jewish rabbi in a synagogue and they're not happy, the Muslims. When I say Muslims, I mean Muslim leaders in this country. Or when I worship in a church, they're not happy, or celebrate Christmas, they're not happy, or have an Easter egg and they're not happy. What's the problem? And I relate to a story which goes like this. Once upon a time, there was a huge crack in a road. And every time a car would come driving at night, the car would flip and it would go off the road. So a man came and took a look at this scene and he saw the cars flipping and he said, well, you know what, this is a good opportunity. So he started his towing company. So now whenever a car flips, he's ready and he says, would you like some service? I'll tow your car. So then another man came and he said, wow, this is a good opportunity. So he opened a mechanic shop right next to it. So now the tow truck is towing the damaged vehicles to the mechanic. Well, the mechanic says, go and come back tomorrow. Someone else came and said, well, it's good to have a motel over here. So they started the motel. And the motel had a restaurant. Slowly, slowly, they realized there were children coming in these vehicles and they needed a hospital for the children and they needed a childcare center. And then police needed to start doing patrols in that area. And slowly, slowly, it grew into a small town. Why? Because there was a crack in that road. But as soon as someone wanted to fix that crack in the road, the entire town came out protesting against that person because they're living off the broken road. This is Islam today. They're living off a broken ideology. And as soon as someone wants to come out and fix it, the entire country, whether it be an Islamic government or its missionaries, are not happy. Now, there are other government agencies that have their agendas within Australia. This is something very obvious. The Iranian revolution and the Saudi Arabian regime, they all funding our political parties and funding our schools and wishing to change, spread their ideology. But there's one thing we Australians can do to stop this. And that is, if we understood the fact that the problem we have with radical Islam is an ideological problem. It's a problem of ideology. It is not a problem of personal revenge. The Muslims might not be happy that the West came and took their petrol. But look at Dubai. America came, took their petrol, now it's heaven on earth. We don't just take, we take and we give. But it's your rulers that take, and if you talk, you're executed. That's the difference between our Western values and their lifestyle. And I said earlier today that the blame usually is thrown against the Zionists, saying that the Zionists are the ones that created radical Islam. And that's not true. Zionism takes advantage of what is already there. There was already a radical scripture that they funded and created an ideology out of. I believe that the entire religion needs a review. I believe that there are certain books that need to be banned from this country. There are books that are regarded the second book after the Quran. And all mainstream Muslims believe in this book, the Bukhari, a very famous book. It's present in at least the majority of Muslim homes, at least. It's everywhere. It's put on the shelf right beside the Quran. And every act of terrorism is taught from that book. And that book is widely available and sold and published in Australia. And sometimes even given to prisoners to tell them that, hey, you have a second chance. Now, I don't understand how Muslims believe that, well, radical Muslims is the main issue here, how they believe that if you blow yourself up, you go have lunch with the Prophet Muhammad in heaven. I didn't know my Prophet was running a restaurant up there. I honestly never knew. And then you have other very attractive statements that they state, that you go and you get 72 virgins. But what kind of a virgin is she that I would have to blow myself up for her? There are things in religion that need reformation, and they will be reformed. And it's not very hard to reform. All you need to do is point the finger at what is wrong. Once upon a time, they asked a man in Iran, how did you learn beautiful manners? And he said, I learned it from the disrespectful people. When I saw the good pointing out the bad, I knew that that was the wrong choice to make. I did the opposite of what the bad people do. That's how you learn good manners. If we start pointing the fingers at the Grand Mufti, at every corrupt imam, every corrupt Muslim leader, and put them in their place, Islam will slowly, slowly change. Because we're living in Australia. There are many things that can take the Muslim's mind off radicalization. We have cinemas. We have beautiful ovals. We have everything. We have lovely TV shows. There's no color TV where they come from. It's beautiful. You have cinemas. Cinemas are banned in Saudi Arabia. It's not very hard. The atmosphere is here. We just need to make use of it. And I also oppose the construction of mosques. We have a big problem. Changing this country is something I am against. You can have one mosque in Adelaide, which is the oldest mosque, and then you can have centers. You can have educational centers. You can rent out university theaters, community centers. There's no need to be building mosques that later on are led by radical Muslim leaders. Some of them don't find success in radicalizing the youth that come to the mosque to worship God. So what do? They ride their cars, they drive their cars with their boats from Western Australia, as you may have heard, all the way to Queensland, because they want to join ISIS through Malaysia. And I've always called on to ASIO to check the bank accounts of Muslim imams and who's funding them. And do these people that fund them, do they have expectations from them to brainwash these children? What's going on with genital mutilation and child brides, and what's happening in this country? Now, I'm not a politician, but when something is going wrong, I believe I'm brave enough to distance myself away from it and work against it. But the main issue is we're not finding response from the Muslim community at all. There are a minority that agree with what I do and would sit with a Jewish and a non-Muslim and a Christian and have a wonderful meal. But there are those, and they're the majority, that do not agree with modernizing the religion to make it compatible with the society we are living in. This here is where the clash happens. It's one problem when you have a doctor abusing the body of a female girl that's just been born. It's a larger problem when you have a religious leader that allows it to happen within the community. We need to unite Muslims and non-Muslims ideologically and agree on one fact, that the people of falsehood will only think they are truthful if the truthful remain silent. If you have a blog, if you write a column in the newspaper, do whatever you can. Now, I know there are some politicians in recent times that have stood up and they're very against Islam. And they want to tell people that Islam is a very dangerous religion. Why do they say that? Now, I don't oppose these politicians because I know exactly what filth is in my religion. I know exactly what's going on, which is why I don't speak out against them. I'm against generalizing because there are good Muslims. But the main message behind it, I agree with. Islam is the fastest growing religion on earth. I'm not speaking 100 a day. I'm speaking 20,000 a day. In one city, Alexandria, the whole of Egypt. Like that, 20,000 embrace Islam in one day. I know that it's a Muslim environment, but their grandparents never embraced Islam that fast, 20,000 families in one day. It's growing. We don't have a problem with it growing in the right direction. But if it's growing in the wrong direction, that's where myself and other good people who love their countries believe that it's time to stand. And that's what I'm doing. I went in 2016 to Korea. I joined in the largest peace summit on earth. And I hugged Christians and I laughed with Jews and we sat down. And I mentioned Jews a lot because, although this will get me in trouble, I've never said this before, but Palestine is Jewish land. I mean, come on, who doesn't know this? Jesus came to Jerusalem. He came to the Israelites who were there. It's Jewish land. I mean, if the Jews later on want to become Christians, believe in Jesus, and then later on they want to believe in Muhammad, that's fine, you can change your religion, but you can't change the history of the land. It's Jewish land. Which is maybe why I get along with Jews a lot. But it's a good thing to know the truth and follow it. It's a beautiful thing to be honest to yourself, to history, and to the land you live upon. Now, as for Australia, it is the most successful multicultural country on earth. And I say that because I've traveled everywhere, literally everywhere, every continent. And I've met with many people who are leaders, faith leaders, diplomatic leaders from around the world. We live in a very good city because Adelaide is the most successful multicultural city, South Australia being a state in the whole of Australia. Well, it's a good thing we've embraced Muslims and non-Muslims that come from other countries. But we're not ready to change our life to accommodate other people's beliefs. That's not going to happen. We embrace you to join us in the way we live. But we will not change. And another issue is our politicians. It's about time the female politicians stop dressing in headscarves when they go to Muslim countries. I know it's good to respect other people, but if you're the foreign minister, you're a foreign minister with your uniform and your badge, and if they don't respect you as a woman to come and dress in what you like to dress, then that's a country we don't want their embassy, we don't want anything to do with them. If they don't respect our foreign minister, regardless of what country that is. There's no need to compromise when it comes to Muslims. Look, this is Australia. This is what it is. You like it, don't like it. We'll give you one of our kangaroos and you can hop back to where you came from. In 2017, I have certain goals. The first goal is I want to visit every church and every synagogue and every Buddhist temple. And I want to sit with everyone from every religion and every culture. And I want to open my heart to everyone as a Muslim man. I don't need a community to walk behind me for me to become a leader. A doctor is a doctor regardless whether he has patients or not. Still a doctor. And for as long as I have been assigned by the Grand Islamic Jurisdiction to represent my faith in Australia, I will do that with the best possible ways. And I will use every method possible to bring peace back to this country after the sad incidents that we've had with the siege in Sydney. He was an imam, a Sydney siege. Man Monis, he was an imam. He wasn't just a regular Muslim that was brainwashed. The problem is with the imams and the Grand Mufti. I know I'm limited on time, but the Grand Mufti, who's elected to be representing us for 20 years, hasn't come out and said in English that I condemn terrorism. It's true that he endorses verdicts against ISIS. But the problem is, Australia needs to stand against ISIS. The Muslim community here needs a verdict against ISIS. Not someone in America, and you're giving them the thumbs up, good on you. No, we need to take a stand against ISIS because we are worthy of that. We deserve a Muslim community that takes a stand against terrorism, because that's the fine line between hypocrisy and not. If you're not a hypocrite, then speak out. And they say silence is a sign of approval. And I do not approve of the extremism in this country that has been brought by Muslims from the Middle East. And I refuse to stay silent. Thank you very much. God bless you.
Thank you, Jeffrey. Thank you, Oman, for that courageous and insightful address.
God bless you.
I think you make a good Rotarian.
Thank you. It would be an honour, an absolute honour.
We are apolitical and a-religious, as you probably know, but we espouse those sorts of values. And the interesting thing is that Rotary started in 1905, coming out of a Christian country, and espouses these sorts of values. Most of us have, you know, sort of that background, as you know. The thing is, Christians went through a period of reformation in the 15th century, and there were lots of horrible things that in history tells us about that evolution. And I just wonder, thinking about your suggestion that the ideology changes, realistically, how can that happen and how long will it take?
Thank you very much. How to change a religion is as easy as creating a religion. You need one book, one man who knows how to talk, and lots of money. And in some areas, a few bodyguards. That's all you need to start a religion. But how do you reform a current ideology? Number one, government needs to realize that the books that are being taught in Muslim schools and that are in the shelves of mosques need to be taken out, opened up, see the publisher, and posted back to where they came from. Simple as that. We don't need to burn anything. We don't need to create tension. Just gather the books, and thank you very much. That's number one. Secondly, secret services need to monitor the movements of every religious leader. The lectures, if they're in Arabic, what are they saying? The examples they use, do they have private lessons? Money in the bank accounts? How many wives do they have? This is very important. Many people don't realize this. Muslims have more than one wife in this country. Now, I know religion says you can have more than one wife. Many other religions do so. Many denominations in Judaism and Buddhism allow that. But we need to come to one common understanding that it's either we follow the law of the land or we don't. If we do, then it's one wife. If we don't, then go back to where you came from and have as many wives as you like. It might sound harsh. This line, go back to where you came from, might sound very harsh. And it might sound very uneducated or uncivil. But that's the only way to achieve peace. This is how we are. If we're not good enough to allow you to live the life you want with four wives, then we're sorry. We'll pay for your ticket, go back. We're sorry, we can't have it here. That's the formula of peace. For you is your religion and for me is mine. You can practice your religion at home. But when it comes to changing the lives of other people on the expense of your beliefs, no, it won't happen. It cannot happen. So that's secondly, the imams. Thirdly, is opening the doors of opportunity for the moderate Muslims to speak. In Australia, where there's freedom of speech and where there's democracy, many Muslims do not find it safe to speak out against extremism in their country at all. And when I say they're afraid, they're not afraid of isolation, they're afraid of death. And I've been very close to that. And God saved me many times. But there's a reality that needs to be addressed. The only way to change a religion is through educational means and security, national security, banning books that teach extremism and monitoring the preachers. Thank you. Man has a question.
John, a question.
Sir, what is the difference between the Sunnis and the Shia? If you can pull that one so we understand why the Bible is
not. Okay, thank you. Islam has 73 denominations. Christianity has 74. The Jews have 72. Now, these denominations come from two major schools of thought in Islam, the Sunni and the Shia. The Sunni school of thought believes that after the Prophet Muhammad, it is the caliphs that rule, Abu Bakr, Umar, and Uthman. They rule after the Prophet Muhammad. The Shi'a believe, after the Prophet Muhammad, a man by the name of Ali rules and then his grandchildren. What's the difference between the two? Ali believes, and that's who I follow, Ali believes that God sent his religion to guide people and not govern them with it. The Sunnah believe that the caliph is a caliph. He governs, he rules, he does whatever he wants. Which is why we Shia are the ones being executed today by ISIS, who stem from the Sunni school of thought. So it's either you pledge allegiance to me, or it's gonna be a bad situation. And you know, shame on a religion, shame on a nation that kills the household of its own prophet. That's what the caliphs did. The caliphs, after the Prophet Muhammad, they massacred the household of the Prophet himself. So it's got nothing to do with Trump and Netanyahu and Israel. No. The Arabs themselves, during that time, they couldn't agree on a simple system of listening to who you believe in. And he was the Prophet. And they wouldn't listen to him. So what's the point of guiding those people? And that just grew into a new ideology. And now we clash. Ideologically is how I clash with them. But I don't know why they want to kill me for. I don't know. So we see it ideological, they see it personal. Thank you.
This is one of those lunches where you don't really want to look at the clock and just keep going. And I thank you all for your attention. Imam, that was an inspirational speech. And I'd like to present you with this small token of our appreciation of your visit today. Thank you very much. Thank you, Darcy.